Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In this section, we get to continue on with our discussion of how a lessee records a lease. Now, we've already talked about why leases are so important, some of the basic definitions, the rules FASB started coming up with on how to classify a lease, and then we ended last time with a calculation of the amortization table for the lessee. We did some cool present value calculations and then saw how it all came together to give us a zero balance once all the payments were made. What we didn't have time for were the journal entries, and it was a total bummer. But now, I promise you, first thing we were going to do was jump into journal entries. So hopefully you're comfortable with this table, because we're going to take these numbers, and we're going to jump right into the journal entries. And we're going to do them side by side, the finance option and the operating option, so that we can see the differences in the lessee's two methods. And I guess I should take just a second really fast, even though I promised first thing was going to be journal entries. Last thing we need to do before we jump into those is, wait a minute, is this a finance or an operating lease? And the way that we would do that is we would compare this $211,574 to the $300,000, and we would see that we're only paying about 70% of the fair market value. There is no incentive to buy this asset at the end. At least not that we know of. So that doesn't make it a financing lease. We don't own it for the major part of its useful life because it's only 4 out of 6 years. So that's 66%. So you could go either way. You could say that, oh, you know, 2/3 of its life or 70% of its fair value, that's the majority. Let's call it a financing lease. But you could also say, you know, we're nowhere near a majority. We're high, but we're not at the majority yet. So we're going to call it an operating lease. And chances are most companies would err on the side of this being an operating lease. And those would be the journal entries that they would really make. Now again, we're going to make both kinds just for the fun of doing journal entries. But be aware, this would probably end up being an operating lease. So I've got this all set up and ready for us to go through and do the journal entries. And we're going to start with year one. And let's start right on January 1 with our finance lease. We need to record the right of use asset. And I'm going to abbreviate that right of use asset. And I'm not going to jump back and forth to the table, but all of the numbers that we're using will come from that table. So you might want to have that table handy. We calculated this to be $226,574. Remember, it was the sum of the lease liability and the initial direct costs. We're now going to record cash payments that were made at the beginning of this lease. Remember, we paid out $15,000. This was to our lawyer and others to help actually create this lease. And then we actually cut another check to the lessor. And normally, you'd put both of those together, but just for the sake of showing what's going on, I'll keep them separate. $56,825 would be our cash going out to the lessor as our first payment, which means on this first day, our lease liability is only $154,749. And if we go back to our table, you can see there's that $154,749, and there's the $226,574, and there's the $15,000, and there's the $56,825. So all of our numbers coming from this table. This is to record the right of use asset and the lease liability. All right, what about an operating lease, which is what we said this lease would probably be? Well, the nice thing for us is that journal entry would look exactly the same, which is really nice because then we only have to learn one method. We'll just put all the cash together. We wouldn't normally break it out as lawyer or lessor anyway. You normally just have one credit to cash, so we'll go ahead and do that. And that's step two, is creating this right of use asset and recording the lease liability. Step three are all the other journal entries that we have to make with this lease. And we need to start on 12/31. We need to record interest expense. And again, we get that right from our table. So our first year of interest expense is 7,737. And we put that into our lease liability instead of having a separate interest payable. This is to accrue interest. And then we'd also need to record amortization expense in accrued amortization. Normally with an asset, we use depreciation, accumulated depreciation, but FASB prefers amortization for a leased asset just to kind of differentiate between the stuff we actually own, depreciation, and the stuff we don't own. So not necessarily required. You could still call it depreciation, but this is FASB's recommendation. Depreciation on our lease. And the way we're going to calculate that is we're going to take our 226, 574 minus our salvage value. In this case, we're giving the asset back to the lessor, so it's worth nothing to me. And I'm only going to own it for 4 years, and then it goes back to the lessor. And if we round to the nearest dollar, that becomes 56,644. And that's how we do it with a finance lease. Now, just so you know, if we were to do this with a bargain purchase option, or if there was a transfer of ownership, so I was going to keep this asset, then I would use the real salvage value at the end of a normal economic life. If I'm not going to keep it, but I've guaranteed the residual, I kick that residual value in there because I want it to be worth that much when I give it back to the lessor. And we'll see an example of that later. What do we do if it's an operating lease? Well, this is one of the more challenging methods that FASB's come up with. Once you get the hang of it, it's not that bad, but you do have to get the hang of it. So let's walk through it. We're going to start with a lease expense. And the way you calculate the lease expense is you sum up the undiscounted lease payments. You're going to add the initial direct costs, and then you're going to subtract any lease expense from prior years. So in this case, to get the undiscounted lease payments, I take that 56,825, that's our lease payment, I multiply it by 4, which is the 227,300 that we have right down here. That's our undiscounted lease payments, just the sum of what we're actually paying. The initial direct costs were $15,000, and so far I've recognized no lease expense in prior years. So I would add these up, and that gives me $242,300, and I divide by the number of years in the lease. And that gives me my lease expense. So that number is going to come up here at $60,575. Now, let me just stop here. This seems like a really complicated equation. There's a lot of steps there. Do we really have to do this? No, you don't. Well, only once. If you don't change anything, so you don't change your lease payments and change the calculations or record some extra lease expense 1 year for various reasons, you don't ever have to recalculate this. The one time where this really becomes a big deal is if you use a variable lease payment, which some companies do. It's not as common, which is why we're not going to study it. But there is that option. The lease payment varies. And if the lease payment varies, then this changes based on interest rates and market pressures, etc. If it's a set payment, like we're studying, then once you get that number, you're done. You just use that same number every time, which is really nice. But just be aware that if you use variable payments, that's where this changes. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to put into the lease liability the accrued interest on this lease liability. And that's that 5% that we calculated. It's this number that we've already used. And the plug is accrued amortization or accumulated amortization. And in this case, that's $52,838. And these numbers will change each period. This one won't, but these two will. And this is to record interest and amortization or depreciation, however you want to use it, on our lease. And that's step two. And step three, we'll make these same kinds of journal entries every single period. The numbers will change as the interest amount changes, but the basics are the same. So with that in mind, let's jump right into year two and do those journal entries. And we'll go ahead and do the operating lease first on this one. So January 1, I have a lease payment that I'm making for $56,825, and cash is going to go out. Payment on the lease, and that's all I need to do for the lease payment. On December 31st, I'll again record a lease expense. Since I'm not using variable payments and I haven't changed my contract in any way, that's going to be the same number we saw before. What's going to change, though, is the interest is different. So my credit to lease liability will be the second number from our table. So instead of the 7737, I'm going to use the 5283. And again, my plug is the accrued or accumulated amortization. And that's going to be $55,292. This is to record interest and amortization on lease. And that's it for an operating lease. For a financing lease, I will also have a payment on January 1. And that's cash going out. Payment on lease. And again, I'll have two journal entries this time. I'll have interest expense, 5283, and again, we'll put that in the lease liability instead of into an interest payable. This is interest on lease. And then we'd have our amortization expense and accumulated amortization. And that number's not going to change. It'll be the same every period because I'm using straight line amortization. By the way, you don't have to use straight line. If you choose to use double declining balance or one of the other methods, you're welcome to do that. Now, hopefully that method makes sense to you. You can see the logic here as we're going through. Again, not complicated once you get the hang of it and once you get that amortization schedule done. That's the real important issue when you do leases. If you get that amortization table done, you're set. You're just pulling numbers right from there. So, which is why that was one of our key concepts, making that amortization table so important. We're going to stop here. Before you come back, please do the journal entries for year three. We'll go through them briefly, and then we'll do the journal entries for that last year and wrap up our example for the lessee. We'll see you then. Thanks.